first a little bit about what we did yesterday, the wedge problem. And we had this wedge problem or challenge, whatever you want to call it, because in the basic theory you had in the denominator a sine with four angles, and if the sum of those four angles approach 180 degrees, we have a problem because you divide by zero or by something close to zero, which would give very high forces or even negative forces, and especially negative forces cannot exist. So what did it look like? And in fact, this is a wedge with a blade of 120 or 130 degrees. And you could wonder, when will that occur? Well, for example, we started this research end of the 90s, because in those days tunnel boring machines were very interesting. And if you look at a tunnel boring machine, and not many people think of that, it's a huge cylinder. It could have a diameter of 16 to 18 meters, the size of one tunnel channel. But if this tunnel boring machine would rotate in one direction constantly, it also means you get a side force on the tunnel boring machine, and the tunnel boring machine tends to turn in one direction. So with tunnel boring machines, you would like it if they can move in both directions. That means you cannot just put a blade in the front of the tunnel boring machine, but they put blades like this. So in that case, whether you move in this direction or in the opposite direction, the cutting process is the same. But if with such a sort of pick point you move like this, you get a process like in the picture. If it would be like this, you would have 90 degrees. If it's like this, you have 120, 130 degrees. And that's why we investigate that, because we wanted to be able to predict the forces and the torque, etc., the power on tunnel boring machines. And that's where we found that we couldn't apply the original theory. If you look at oil drilling, basically in oil drilling, you have two mechanisms to drill to make the hole. The original method is that you have rotating, it's not really a blade, it's a rotating device at the top of the drill. Not just one, but you have a number of those things, and then because of the high pressure, the rotating device is rotating over the rock. Because of the high pressure, you crush the rock under the drill. So in fact, it's not drilling in terms of cutting the rock, but because of the high pressure, the rock will collapse, and that's how you remove the material. So that's one method. Then later, they also made drilling devices with real cutters. They often call it PDF cutters. I showed you a picture in one of the first lectures. We call it Stratapax cutters. And those are small plates of artificial diamond, because diamond is the hardest material. It's harder than the hardest rock, so you can actually cut the rock. And if I would put such a cutter like this and cut through the rock, the diamond would collapse. It would let go of the steel behind it. If I do it like this, then the pressure on the diamond is at the front, and the diamond will stick, because you have a normal pressure on the diamond. So those small cutters, they are about 1 centimeter, they move like this, and they actually scratch a very thin layer of rock from the bottom of the hole where we are drilling. Yeah, so that's also a process where you have a blade angle bigger than 90 degrees. And if in the equation we have the sum of all those angles, and I have a blade angle of, let's say, 120 degrees, yeah, then it's easy to get close to the 180, and then we are in trouble with the original model. So this could be a tunnel boring machine, it could be a drilling device for drilling oil, boats, and there are also other options, like if I have a clamshell, a grijper, and the clamshell starts closing, usually I drop the clamshell on the soil, and that means that the cutting edges in the beginning are at about 90 degrees, yeah, because it drops vertically, and I like it if those two buckets of the clamshell penetrate as deep as possible in the soil. So I start with 90 degree blades, and then when the clamshell is closing, the blade angle is decreasing, and when the clamshell closes completely, usually we have maybe just 15 degrees. Although I said we don't like 15 degrees, but if you look at clamshells, mostly when they are closed, the bottom is almost horizontal. Yeah, it's not like this, it's almost horizontal. So with those clamshells, you also have to deal with high cutting angles, starting at, well, usually a little bit more than 90 degrees, because it opens at an angle more than 90 degrees, but during the closing, constantly the blade angle is changing. So also for clamshells, we like to know what exactly is going on. If I do a simulation with a clamshell and I would just use the original theory without the wedge, and the forces become very high, and in the case of a 90 degree blade, the friction force is upwards, and then in a simulation the clamshell would never enter the soil because the forces are so high. So you really have to know what is going on there. So we have this wedge, the blade, the wedge in front. Here you have the wedge angle, and basically here you have the original cutting process. And this could occur in sand, in clay, in rock, maybe, but we know from sand and clay that it occurs. We had all the forces I already showed you yesterday, so I will not go in detail. The only important thing here is that you see a lambda instead of a phi, and the reason for that I already explained once. The reason for that is that here you have sand which has already been subject to dilatation, and that probably means that the angle of internal friction is a little bit smaller than the original angle of internal friction. And to take that into account, I just used a different symbol, because then I can use two different values in my equations. Forces on the wedge. Very important for the wedge is that here you have the delta, the angle of external friction. And why is that so important? Well, as long as the wedge is not moving, you do not know whether the external friction is upwards or downwards. It can be in between a maximum and a minimum, and I will show you some graphs what happens to show what happens with that angle of external friction. Forces on the blade, and they are always opposite to the forces on the, in this case, the wedge. The moments are important to determine how much of the friction is mobilized. Yeah, if it's fully mobilized 100%, I don't really need the moment equation, but as long as it's not fully mobilized, I just need a third equation, because my delta is one of the unknowns. Yeah, and the number of equations should be equal to the number of unknowns, so that's why I need that one. Well, again, just like with the original process, you have water flowing to the zone where you have dilatation, and in fact this is the shear plane, and in the shear plane we will have the dilatation, so that's where we need the water. The wedge is assumed not to have dilatation because, like I told you yesterday, sand can only have that dilatation once. Once the porosity in the sand has increased and it's filled up with water, it will not happen again. Yeah, so I assume in the wedge you don't have dilatation, so the water doesn't flow. Well, it could flow a little bit through the wedge, but in general not much. The boundary conditions for the finite element calculations, same as without a wedge. Only difference is, of course, now the dpdn equals zero, which means an impermeable wall is here, it's the blade, and this shear plane between the wedge and the layer cut, water can flow through that shear plane. Yeah, because it's all sand, so the water can flow there. A coarse mesh, but it already looks like a fine mesh, but this one is even a little bit finer. And also here you can see that near the shear plane and at the bottom of the wedge we used very small elements because we like to know the details of the pressure distribution in such an area. Result with the biggest underpressures in the shear plane but not in the wedge. And like I told, the results of all the finite element programs, calculations, are almost the same for the pore pressures as if the wedge was made of steel and there is no water flowing through the wedge. So basically, after we found out from many calculations that this is the case, basically I use the values for the situation where I don't have a wedge, so the situation where the wedge could be of steel, because we have much more data on that situation. This was flow lines, so you can see in the wedge, well, at the top there is some flow, but in this whole region there is not a lot of flow. And if there is not a lot of flow, it also means there is not much pressure gradient. Yeah, because flow and pressure gradient are related. If I have a high pressure gradient, I will have a high flow, and reversed. This was a picture of the under pressure as a function of the location. B was where the shear plane reaches the surface, so reaches the hydrostatic pressure, so that's where he starts at zero. A was the tip of the wedge, so from B to A is the shear plane, and you can see it increases, it has a maximum somewhere. Then from A to D is the bottom of the wedge, so there it decreases almost linearly, not completely but almost, and then D is the tip of the blade. Here you can see the pressures on the blade, and from C to A is the top of the blade to the tip of the wedge. Yeah, so all the planes that are important, we have four planes in total, you can see what the pressure distribution is. Now, and this is one with a big wedge, and the bottom one is with a very tiny wedge. Yeah? If you have a very thin wedge, for example, if the blade angle would be 75 degrees, probably the wedge in front of that blade is very thin, and then you get such a distribution. Now, the thing is, those pressures are determined based on finite element calculations, and the finite element program, the way we used it, does not take into account whether you have cavitation or not. So there is no limit. In fact, the whole calculation is dimensionless, so I can use it for different blades, for different layer thickness and so on, for different permeabilities. So everything is dimensionless. It means, suppose I would have cavitation, then at the top here I could have a flat area, a horizontal area, because that's the limit of my underpressure. Well, in the finite element calculations you can't take that into account, like I said, because they are dimensionless. But if you would use the parallel resistor method to determine those underpressures, and the result is almost the same, but in the parallel resistor method you can easily say I have a limit. The limit is that and that pressure, which is the total, the absolute hydrostatic pressure, and then you can cut off the top of those underpressures, and in fact you get a more detailed view on the underpressures. Well, that's what we do like this. So again, we have four possible flow lines. You have from each surface you have a flow line, and they go to a point on the shear plane, and with that method you determine the underpressure at that point. But if that underpressure would be higher than the cavitation pressure, than the absolute pressure, then I will give the value of the hydrostatic pressure at that point, and that's how I can cut off the underpressure. Yeah, in that case it will not be a nice smooth curve, but you have a flat area. Advantage is that I can look at the transition between no cavitation and cavitation in a much more detailed manner. Normally we say, okay, we have a line under a certain angle and a horizontal line for cavitation, and the intersection point is the transition between the two. But if I use this method, I get a nice smooth curve, which in fact is better because that's reality. Now, I told you we still have some unknowns in the wedge system. First of all, the wedge angle, so the tip angle of the wedge. I like to predict what that angle would be, and I also would like to know how much is the friction on the blade mobilized. Well, we did many calculations, and this is a graph showing you the moment around the tip of the blade. Yeah, so I choose the tip of the blade as the point where I like to calculate the moments. And what do you see? Well, first of all, here you have the wedge angle, so that's the tip angle of the wedge. What do you see? Well, for four different shear angles, because we do not always know what a shear angle is, we determined the moment, and you can see that the moment is always around zero, in this case at about 55 degrees. But this was for a certain angle of internal friction. Yeah, so with another angle of internal friction it may differ, but I will give you the equation a little bit later. So whatever I choose for my shear angle, the moment is about zero at 55 degrees. Well, that's very nice, because I can say, okay, if I choose 55 degrees for the tip of my wedge, and in fact later I found that this angle is independent of the blade angle, so whether I have a 90 degree blade angle or 120 degree blade angle doesn't matter, the angle of the tip of the wedge is roughly the same. It's almost independent, and in this case 55. Here you also see this same moment, but now I did the calculation for a number of thetas, 40, 50, 55 and 60 degree for the tip angle of the wedge, and now on the horizontal axis you have the shear angle, and the angle of the shear plane. Well, what do you see? You can see the red line, which is the 55 degrees. It starts here a little bit below zero and it ends a little bit above, but roughly that line is almost at zero. So the assumption that that this angle should be 55 degrees is correct. We did some tests in the laboratory. You already saw some pictures, I think, of this laboratory. And in fact, what we would like to know, is the wedge really a static wedge? So is the wedge not moving? Is there no velocity in this wedge? And how do you do that? Well, if you could make a video of the sand sliding over the blade, and then the conclusion is the sand is not sliding, it means you have a fixed wedge, a static wedge. If it's still sliding, it means there's velocity in the wedge. Yeah, so everything is moving. So here you see the blade. Here you see the camera in front of the blade. We made a window in the blade. And behind that window, we put a camera. So you could actually see what all the particles are doing on top of the blade. And here you can see how the camera is mounted behind the blade. Yeah, we used a lot of duct tape, but you have to do something. Well, so our conclusion was, I don't have a video of that, but our conclusion was the wedge is not 100% static. Sometimes we can still see some particles move, but in general it's a static wedge. That's also important to know. If I have this static wedge, it also means the friction is not 100% mobilized. Yeah, because if it would move, it means I have 100% friction. If it doesn't move, it could also be 0%. Yeah. Now, I made some pictures of the forces on a wedge for different blade angles, and you can see how it changes. So this is a, I think this was 75 or 60 degrees. You can see a tiny wedge in front. Here you have the forces that were based on the layer that is moving over the wedge, and here you have the forces on the blade, and you can see that the blade generates a downwards friction force, which means the sand on the blade has an upwards friction force. This is a 120 degree blade, and what do you see there? That those forces are almost the same, so the forces of the layer that you are cutting, they are almost the same. But to get an equilibrium on this wedge, now the forces here on the blade or from the blade on the sand are a little bit different. Now you see a friction force which is upwards. What does that mean? It means that the sand in the wedge is pushing downwards on the blade. In fact, it would like to go under the blade. And that's also what happens in reality. If you have an angle, we did tests with very sophisticated finite elements with shell oil because of what we call ice scour. So you have an iceberg. Everybody knows that 90% is underwater. The iceberg is moving through the soil, whether it's sand or clay. And what you like is to know if, suppose, I make a trench and I put a pipeline in, and between the top of the pipe and the bottom of the iceberg, let's say I have 1 meter. Now the iceberg is coming, moving, let's say, perpendicular on the pipeline. Would the deformations still be so big that the iceberg wants to take the whole pipeline? Because if that happens and the pipeline is doing this, it may buckle or bend and it may damage, and we don't like that. And then it's very important to know if that iceberg is moving, will the sand move up against the iceberg, or is the angle of the iceberg like this and the sand will go under the iceberg? Because you can imagine if it goes under the iceberg, yeah, it will take the whole pipeline. If it moves up, the pipeline is not affected. And those kind of problems seem to be very theoretical, but not for oil companies, because they know if they put a pipeline in the Arctic and the pipeline is damaged because of an iceberg, then the whole public opinion in the whole world will be against them, and it will take 10 years before you can start drilling again in the Arctic. So they really want to be sure that if they do this, if they put pipelines there and they trench, they really want to be sure that it works. So for them it's very important, will the sand move under the blade or under the iceberg, or will it start moving upwards? Yeah, so they like this kind of theories and calculations. I remember the student who did that research, it's a year ago, he used a software called Abacus to do those calculations. Here you see, in fact, the same picture here, the let's say 60 degrees, 75, 90, then this would be 105 and this would be 130. You can see that the forces on the wedge, every time they are the same. But you can see that the force on the blade, the friction force on the blade, first the blade pushes the sand downwards, and here it pushes the sand upwards. And you can see how you get a transition from one mechanism to the other mechanism. Well, let's look at some data. I made calculations. This is for an internal friction angle of 40 degrees. And in this picture you can see three angles, the alpha, the beta and the delta. And in fact in this picture I mixed up the blade angle and the wedge angle. So the alpha is the wedge angle and what is called theta here is the blade angle, so it should be reversed, but I will do that for next time. So if the blade angle is increasing from 60 to 120 degrees, what do we see? What do we actually see? We see a wedge angle which is almost 50 degrees all the time. Now if you see that, then for somebody who is in soil mechanics, he will say, okay, so that's 90 minus the angle of internal friction. And in fact, that's what it is. So the wedge angle is almost equal to 90 minus the angle of internal friction. And that happens all the time. In this case, I had an external friction angle, which is 2/3 of the internal friction angle. And that means the external friction angle when it's fully mobilized is 27 degrees. So for the external friction angle we start here with plus 27 degrees, which means the sand, you have a 60 degree blade, the sand is moving upwards, so I have an upwards friction on the blade, but the blade is pushing the sand down, yeah, because that's always reversed. Why does it start here and not sooner? Well, you can see that if the blade angle becomes smaller, there will not be a wedge at all. If I have a blade smaller than 60 degrees, I cannot even make a drawing of a wedge in front of the blade. So below 60 degrees, there will not be a wedge at all. Yeah? So up to 60 degrees, I will always have the cutting process without a wedge. Okay, now when I'm increasing my blade angle, what do I see? I see a decrease of my external friction, and somewhere near 90 degrees it's zero, which means there is no friction at all. And then it becomes negative, which means it's in the opposite direction. Then you see somewhere here, a little bit above 110 degrees blade angle, you can see that it's fully mobilized in the opposite direction, and then the friction will be constant because the friction cannot be bigger than minus or smaller than minus 27. So here it's constant again. What you can also see in all the calculations that the beta, which was the shear angle, is almost constant, not 100%. It slightly differs, but it's such a small difference that I would say it's 20 degrees in this case. It also has to do with the accuracy of all your calculations. So the shear angle is almost a constant. Now the forces. Well, like I said, because we have that sign in the denominator, you can see that without a wedge, that's the yellow points, the cutting force is increasing, and it would go to infinity somewhere here, so that's where the sum of the angles is 180 degrees. Yeah, and then if the sum of the angles is more than 180 degrees, it comes back from minus infinity and stays negative, which is nonsense, because it would mean the blade would go by itself. And we know that that will never happen. Yeah? So this is the outcome of a situation without a wedge, and the red line is the same, but then for the vertical force. I also put the line in, the green line, for the case where we have a wedge. And what do you see? A little over the 60 degrees, the two lines cross each other, and well, in the theory, we say that you always take the smallest of the two forces, which means in the beginning we take the yellow, so without a wedge, and above, in this case, something like 65 degrees, we will take the green line, and you can also see the green line is not increasing a lot. It does increase a little bit, but not too much. Well, that's very important, because I gave you the example of the clamshell. You put it on the soil, underwater, and if I would have such a force, upwards directed, the clamshell would never go into the soil, because the force is too big. But if the force is the green line, then it's limited, and I just have to take care that the weight of the clamshell is bigger than this upwards force. So once I know this upwards force, I could add weight, just add steel to the clamshell to make it heavier, and then I know it will work. For the vertical force, you can see that in the beginning at 60 degrees it's almost zero, but you can also see in this case that the blue line, which is the vertical force in case of a wedge, is almost zero, so apparently there is not much vertical force. This is a close-up of the area where the two lines intersect, so you can see that, yeah, where is it? It's between 60 and 65 degrees where you have the transition from no wedge to a wedge. Now, why did we discover this just in the last 10 years and not before? Well, we do research for dredging companies, and all the dredging tools have blade angles up to 55 degrees, something like that. So for dredging, this is not really important, although they like to know such a theory. But yeah, for a cutter head or a drag head, it doesn't play any role. But in clamshells, tunnel boring machines, drilling for oil, it does play a role. And if you don't take this into account, you make a big mistake when you calculate forces and powers. I have one more. I will not go into so much detail, but this is 30 degrees. Okay, so 30 degrees, if we have a wedge angle, a tip angle which would be 90 minus the angle of internal friction, then in this case we would expect a tip angle of 60 degrees, and 90 minus 30 is 60. And you can see it's not exactly 60s. Here it's a little bit lower than here, but in the middle it approaches 60. So assuming 60 degrees does not give you a big mistake. You can see it starts also a little bit above 60 degrees, so below there is no wedge. And you can see the delta, the external friction angle, go from plus 20 to minus 20. So this is the range where it changes sign. Yeah, so in fact you see the same as in the previous picture, just for another angle of internal friction. Here you see the forces, same picture, only now the intersection between the two lines is at a bigger blade angle. Yeah, so if the angle of internal friction is smaller, it means for a longer time you will have the original cutting model and the wedge will start at a higher blade angle. Here you see the close-up again, so you can see where is it? It's above 70 degrees. So up to, let's say, 70 degrees in such a sand, I will not have a wedge, but above 70 degrees I will have. This is the cavitating case, but the principle is the same. Yeah, the lines are almost the same. Then the result. The result that I found, this alpha should be the theta. Like I said, I reversed the two signs. So this should be the tip angle of the wedge. And you can see that for no cavitation we found 90, not minus phi exactly, but 2/3 phi. And why 2/3 phi? Because in every case I choose the external friction angle to be 2/3 of the internal friction angle. So basically what this says, the wedge angle is 90 minus the external friction angle. And that's what it says. And for the cavitation case it's a little bit different, so you see this equation. But with those equations I can easily calculate the wedge angle, and once I know the wedge angle I can almost determine everything. Okay, that's the lecture about sand cutting. We will have a break, and then after the break I will do clay cutting. We'll talk a little bit about clay cutting, and then next week I think I will continue with the clay cutting. Yeah, it works. Clay cutting. Well, first, before we start the theory, in clay you have three types of failure. In sand we only had one type of failure, which was the shear type, but in order to do all the calculations we acted like it's a sort of flow type, so a continuous process, because in calculating the under pressures and so on we didn't take into account that it's a cyclic process with all those shear planes, but we acted like it's a continuous process. Well, in clay you never have the shear type, but you can have the curling type, the flow type and the tear type. And in fact the curling type we have if you have a thin layer of material with high adhesion. The flow type is the mid-range, and the tear type is if you have a much thicker layer of material, not a lot of adhesion but a small tensile strength. To calculate the forces in the case of clay, we start with the flow type, and then based on the flow type we will see how can we modify the equations for the curling type and for the tear type. Well, the definitions are the same as in sand, the blade with the tip at point A, the shear plane reaching the surface at point B, and the top of the blade in point C. So we start with the flow type. We always, also with rock, we start with the flow type, and then we will see if the equations are okay, and in certain situations they are not, and then we have to modify the equations. So what do we have in clay? Well, only the cohesive force in the shear plane and a normal force. We assume in clay there is no friction. And that's very important. In clay, they often use the phi equals zero concept. Phi is the angle of internal friction. What does this concept mean? Well, in sand, if you increase the normal stress on a piece of sand, on a sample of sand, then what happens? You compress the sand, but sand still has a reasonable permeability. So if I compress the sand and the porosity is decreasing, then the water will flow out. We call that a drained condition. Yeah, so if there's drainage, if the water can flow, we call it a drained condition. Clay consists of a completely different material, chemically different, but also quartz does not interact chemically with water or with the particles. Clay does. So clay is really a different type of material. Clay particles are very small, like 1 micron or maybe even less. So clay particles are much smaller than sand particles. And clay particles are often flat, so not like a sphere or a sand particle, just a flat piece of material. And clay particles are chemically active. To explain the details would take another lecture, another course, but they are chemically active with water, so they attract water chemically, but also with each other. That means clay particles are chemically connected to each other, and that's what's giving clay shear strength and tensile strength. If particles are not connected chemically, you don't have shear strength, you don't have tensile strength. Yeah? So they are connected. Now, what happens if I put some pressure on clay? Well, if I put pressure on clay, so if I want to compress clay, then the first thing that happens is I have higher pressure in the water in the pores. Because the permeability of the clay is so low, the water will not flow out. If I would build a dike, and I'm considering a time period of 100 years, and I put pressure on the clay, okay, in 100 years, water has time to flow out of the clay. Yeah, in that case, you can consider it a drained situation. But when we are cutting clay, everything goes so fast, in a fraction of a second, that the pore water does not have time to flow out because the permeability is so low, so it would really require very high pressures to push the water out. And you will never reach such pressures. So when I compress the clay, the water takes into account for the additional pressure, not the particles. That means the stress between the particles remains the same. Well, if the stress between the particles remains the same, it also means even if clay would have a friction angle, it means there is no additional friction because the normal stresses between the particles do not change. Yeah? And friction is something depending on normal stress. So if the normal stress between the particles is a constant, also the friction is a constant. So if on the outside I increase my pressure, I will not notice that there is any additional friction in the clay. So I measure a friction angle zero, because the water is doing everything. This is the undrained situation of clay, because no water is flowing. And it happens when you have very fast deformations of the clay. So this is called, in soil mechanics book, they call this the phi equals zero concept. Yeah, so it's a matter of how fast am I deforming the material. Theoretically, if I would deform sand very fast, I could have the same situation, but in the cutting processes, the deformations are not fast enough to get such an undrained situation. Okay, so that's the reason why we do not assume there is an angle of internal friction, and if you don't have the internal friction, you also don't have the external friction. So that's why we only look at the cohesive force in the shear plane. We only have the normal force. We don't have a shear force because there is no friction, effectively. But if I would measure in the laboratory, if I would give a clay sample to the laboratory, probably they would come up with a certain friction angle. That friction angle would be much smaller than in sand, but it would exist. Yeah, but in cutting processes, no friction angle. And since we are talking about cutting processes, fast deformations, in all the cases, if we talk about clay, the friction angle is zero internally and externally. Then on the blade, or between the layer cut and the blade, you have the adhesive force, and of course also a normal force. So the number of forces in this picture is very limited, and you will see the equations are also relatively simple. Forces on the blade, just in the opposite direction. And what I wanted to say, the adhesive force and the cohesive force, they are just the adhesion and the cohesion. Yeah, adhesion and cohesion. We use KPA, and those are strengths, shear strengths, so we use KPA. You just multiply it with the surface they are acting on, so the surface of the shear plane and the surface of the blade, and that's how you get the capital forces, and the capital A and the capital C, those are the forces. In clay, as we will see later, we need the moments on this layer cut in order to determine the curling type. So for the normal flow type, we don't need it. But when we are working on the curling type, if we want to predict what's going on there, we need also the moment equations. And basically, you assume that those normal forces act in the center at 50% of the distance of the shear plane and the blade. And why do you take 50%? Well, on this plane, the cohesion is the same everywhere. So you have a uniform distribution of the cohesive stress, and then we also assume a uniform distribution of the normal stress. And that means that the forces act in the middle. Well, those are the resulting equations. So again, what I did is just take the slide of the total equation with all the forces, delete everything that's not relevant. And what is left, you can see the C, which is the cohesive force, the A, which is the adhesive force. I also deleted both friction angles, because we don't have friction, and only the alpha and the beta are left. So that's for the K2 force on the blade. In fact, in this case, the K2 force is equal to the N2 force, because I don't have friction, so K is N. And then you substitute that in the equations for the horizontal and the vertical force. So the equations are rather simple, but remember, those equations are for the flow type. Yeah. So if we have curling, or if we have the tear type, the equations differ. Then there is something special with clay. We noticed that in clay, the faster you deform the clay, the stronger the clay. We call this strengthening. Yeah, you also have that in other materials, that the strength of the material depends on we call it the strain rate. You could also talk about the shear rate, so the speed at which it is deforming. And to give an explanation of that, we go into physics. By the way, those are two graphs. This is from, some of you may have followed the lectures of Mr. van der Schriek, who is giving a dredging course in civil engineering. It's a bachelor's dredging course. And he has a graph like this, showing how the specific energy is increasing with the speed. I use this graph. And when I talked with him, because he's a member of our department, when I talked with him, I said, how did you get this graph? And he said he tried to copy my graph, but he didn't know the equations, so he just used another equation. And because I hoped he would have some publications telling about this, which would give me more information, but then he based his graph also on my own graph. So, but this is according to the theory, and I will explain how to get there. This is the equation I'm using, and so before we look at the details, first I will explain the equation. This tau is the shear strength, so that's the cohesion. The cohesion is equal to a certain yield stress, and maybe you know something about non-Newtonian fluids like Bingham fluids. There you also have a yield stress, which is the stress that you had, the strength that you have at velocity zero. So if I don't have any velocity, I have this yield strength. And very often when you do tests in a laboratory, this is the strength you get from the laboratory, because they do the tests at very low speed. Yeah, so this is the number you get from the laboratory. Then this tau zero is just some proportionality coefficient, and then you see the logarithm, and between brackets you see the flux of epsilon, and epsilon is the deformation, so the flux of epsilon is the deformation rate and the speed at which it is deforming, and flux epsilon zero is a constant. Each material has a certain constant for this, so you could measure that in the laboratory. It means if my strain rate is zero, yeah, so if this flux epsilon is zero, I get the logarithm of 1, which is 0, and only the yield stress is left. That's why we call it the yield stress. Yeah, so this equation shows the graph in the previous slide. How to get to such an equation? Well, we go to statistical mechanics. And in statistical mechanics, they say, and the first thing we look at is the straight line. What do they say in statistical mechanics? They say, and we look at atom level, not at particle level, but at atom level, all atoms or molecules have a certain vibration energy. And if you have something at rest, this vibration makes those molecules vibrate in both directions, or maybe in 3D direction, but in every direction in the same way. So some molecules will move in one direction, but the same amount of molecules may move in another direction. But for molecules to move within the system of molecules, hey, it could be a crystal or whatever, they have to pass a certain limit. If the vibration energy is below a certain level, they will stick where they are. They vibrate, but they stay where they are. But if the vibration energy at a certain moment of time would exceed this limit, they move to the next position. But the number of molecules that move in one direction is the same as the number of molecules in the other direction, and that's why this table is still a table, because if it would be otherwise, the table would slowly move to one side, and everybody knows that's not going to happen. Now, if you apply a certain shear force, but it could also be a normal force, if you apply a certain shear force to those molecules, so that's this shear force, that means in the direction of the shear force you kind of lower that limit, but in the opposite direction it's increased. So, because the shear force helps molecules to move in a direction, but it hinders them to move in the opposite direction. So, if I have a shear force, shear stress, then I will have a net flux of molecules in that direction. And in fact, that's what happens in fluids. If I put a shear stress on a fluid, I get a net flux of molecules in the direction of the shear stress. This theory uses the so-called Boltzmann distribution. And I put the equation at the bottom, but the only thing you should know from this equation is the T is temperature, so it's all temperature dependent. The Boltzmann distribution starts at a certain value and goes asymptotically to infinity. That means, and on the horizontal axis you have the vibration energy of those molecules. That means theoretically that there is a probability, this is a probability distribution, there is always a probability of a molecule having an infinite vibration energy. Probably this will never happen, but it's the mathematical description. Yeah, like if you use the normal distribution as a probability distribution, usually it works around the average. But if you go far away from the average, you can also go to the negative axis, and then everybody knows in many cases negative values will never occur. Yeah, like if you would count the number of people standing in line for a bus, you can use a normal distribution over time for those number of people, but there will never be a negative number of people waiting for the bus. Yeah, so this normal distribution works in a certain range, but you cannot apply it at the end. Now, if you would use this energy distribution for determining how molecules will move through fluids, solids, whatever, yeah, because there is still a probability that a single molecule has an infinite energy, vibration energy, that means that if I put an infinitely small shear stress on the material, still particles would start moving in that direction. That would mean, for example, because it's not just shear stress but also gravity, yes, so vertically, that means that the pyramids are now 1 meter lower than when they built them. Because of gravity, constantly they go down, because there is molecules under the influence of gravity that start moving. Well, we know this doesn't really happen. So what to do? Well, I will skip those. You can say, okay, in a normal lifetime of an object, the probability of the Boltzmann distribution has to be cut off at a certain limit. So this is a very practical approach. We just say there is a limit to the maximum vibration energy of those molecules. Well, doesn't sound unreasonable, because I don't think myself in physics you will find molecules with an infinite vibration energy. So you just cut off the Boltzmann distribution. Then what you have to do, and you can see here, you have to correct the distribution, because the total surface under the distribution should be 1. Yeah, the total probability should always be 1, so you have to correct by dividing by the part you are missing. Now we can have a number of cases. If you have, and that energy to go over the hill we call activation energy. So if you are at a certain point where in both directions you have a certain activation energy, but if it's within this probability, nothing is changing. Yeah, if you want to know really in detail, just read the lecture notes. I put the whole story there with many more equations. But if this is the situation, nothing has changed with respect to the original distribution. So it still means everything starts moving if there is a little shear stress. So this would be the case for a fluid. Now, the next case, we are close to this limit, but this... This still gives the equation of a fluid. The third case, where the average vibration energy is beyond the probability distribution, that will give me the equation that I want. But there is still a fourth case, and that's when everything is outside the probability distribution. Well, that means it will never happen, because it's outside. Now, you don't have to understand all the equations, but you have to understand the final equation. And not this one, later one. Here I just, for the case 3, I wrote down the equation for the tau. So this is the equation for the shear strength based on that Boltzmann distribution. Here you can see that Mr. Mitchell in 1976 also found, based on this, he found the equation that we use in normal soil mechanics. And finally, we get this equation, which is the equation I showed you at the beginning. If we wouldn't cut off the probability distribution, to show you the relation between that and the equation, if you don't cut off the probability distribution, you don't have the yield stress. Yeah? Only if you cut off that distribution, you get a yield stress. Otherwise, you only have this term. Now, if you look into literature, there is a number of other equations, those three equations, people use in many applications. We are specifically interested in clay. What does it do for clay? Well, we have some measurements here, and in this graph I put the equations of different people, and the black line is the equation we just derived. Here you see measurements. So this is the shear strength, this is the strain rate, and the strain rate you can also say the cutting velocity. Yeah, there's just a factor between the two. Well, what do you see? You can see that in the mid-range of deformations the data points match everything, but for very low strain rates, which means I have a cutting velocity of almost zero, I find this yield strength, but the other equations don't. They go to zero. Yeah, so the other equation, they would also assume that the Bingham fluid starts in the origin, not at a certain yield strength. So you need that yield strength to get the full behavior of your material. This is the same picture, but with now this is a linear scale, and in the other one it was a logarithmic scale, but the data points are the same. So you can see that in order to have a yield strength, so also at zero velocity the material has a strength, you need such an equation. So we use that equation, and here I compare it with some fluid equation, the Herschel-Bulkley equation and the Casson equation, and you can see only at the beginning, at very low strain rates, there is some difference, and for the rest, they are almost the same. So you can actually use that equation in almost every case. So it matches the data points, and for dredging applications, we found for measurements in clay that the dynamic cohesion of clay, so that's including this strengthening effect, is about 2 times the static cohesion. And that's very important, because if you go to a laboratory with some clay samples and you say, I like to know the shear strength of the clay, you get a certain value. Well, if they say it's 50 kPa, then in your cutting equations you have to use 100 kPa. It's 2 times, just because of this strengthening effect. Again, the equations, so those you already saw, but I also here I put the equations for the cohesive force and the adhesive force. This is the shear strength, the cohesion, and this is the surface of the area where it acts. The small a is the adhesive shear strength, and this is the surface again. if we completely substitute those equations in the cutting equation, you find this equation for the horizontal force, where the CD, the D stands for dynamic, so it means you have to use your dynamic strength. So this is the cohesion, the layer thickness, the adhesion, the blade height, and beta was the shear angle, alpha was the blade angle. So here you have one nice equation to determine your cutting forces. What we like to do, and I think in the lecture notes I used an R for this, we like to take the ratio between the adhesive force and the cohesive force. And here I called it K. I think in the lecture notes I called it R, but we will see. If you substitute this into the equation, you get a term here with the K, so the ratio between adhesion and cohesion, and outside you have the cohesion, the layer thickness, and the width of the blade. So that's very nice, because if I know that in a certain type of clay I have a certain ratio between adhesion and cohesion, it makes the use of the equation easy. What does it look like? What are some of the results? Well, here first I have a graph showing you the shear angle. Yeah, the shear angle is still one of the unknowns, but because the equation for the cutting force is not too complicated, I can say, okay, when, at which shear angle will it fail? Well, when the horizontal force is at a minimum. So I take the derivative of that equation, determine where I have a minimum, and at that shear angle I expect the material to fail. Here you see those shear angles, and this is the horizontal force. Well, I thought I also had the shear angle graph, but maybe it's later. This is the horizontal force for a 400 kPa clay, so it's very strong clay. What do you see? Here you see the R. Well, this R is the same as the K in the previous slide. So an R of 0 means I don't have adhesion. Yeah, because the ratio of adhesion divided by cohesion is zero. It means I don't have any adhesion. In that case, you see the lowest line, which makes sense. If I don't have adhesion, I expect the force to be the lowest. And then here you get 0.25, 0.5, 1 and 2. So there, you could say 2. How can the adhesion be bigger than the cohesion? Well, the reason is, in that term, you have adhesion times blade height divided by cohesion times layer thickness. So if I have a very high blade and a very thin layer, then that ratio can become bigger than 1. Yeah, because then the adhesive force is actually really bigger than the cohesive force. Well, you can see the top one has a shape like this, and you can also see the minimum. So at the minimum, because here we have the blade angle, and you can see how it changes as a function of the blade angle. You can see that there is a certain blade angle where you have a minimum, and that blade angle is around 55 degrees. What a coincidence! All cutter heads have a blade angle of 55 degrees. Yeah, so probably they never did those calculations, but they found from experience that with a 55 degree blade angle it worked very well. And they, the dredging companies, are not only dredging clay, they also dredge sand and rock. But during the years they found, oh, if we do it like this, the force is not too high, or the power is not too high, and it will not stick into the cutter head and block the cutter head. And then later we did research and found that they were right. But it's not that first we did research and we told them how to do it. They already know how to do it based on trial and error. Oh yeah, this is the beta graph. Okay, so horizontally we have the blade angle, vertically the shear angle. You can see that if I don't have any adhesion, the shear angle can become very high. You can also see that if I have a very high adhesion, the shear angle is the lowest. Well, normally we are in this range, and that means shear angles in clay could be between 30 and 40 degrees, which is higher than in sand. And you have to take that into account, because if you are cutting clay, then the shear angle determines the thickness of the layer in front of the blade, and that thick layer, because it gets thicker when it's moving over the blade, if that becomes too thick, it doesn't fit between two blades anymore in a cutter head, and the whole system will be blocked. So I need this angle in order to calculate my maximum production and to see, does it still fit? Then here I have the vertical cutting force, same kind of story. Well, we saw that the dynamic cohesion is about 2 times the cohesion you get from a laboratory. So that's important, and in fact you can calculate it with this equation. If you know the C0 and the epsilon0, you can determine at a certain speed what is this factor. Then from literature we know that cohesion is about 6 times the SPT value of the clay. So if I can get SPT values, usually they know, just 6 times, and I have the cohesive, so the shear strength of my clay. But that means that the dynamic cohesion is roughly 12 times the SPT value, because it's double. Yeah, so if I know the SPT value 12 times and I have a good estimate for my dynamic cohesion. Well, this you already know, specific energy is power divided by production, and then production is also power divided by specific energy. And if I substitute that with the equations you saw before, then here I have the equation of the specific energy of clay, and I just replaced the cohesion that was in the back, I replaced it by 12 times the SPT value. That's all I did. Yeah, so it's not a new equation, but now I use the SPT value. And mostly in dredging, dredging companies will have SPT values from previous projects, so they often can tell you, oh, that clay has about that SPT value. Yeah. What does it give? Well, here you have the SPT value, here you have the specific energy, here you see that Ka or R, that ratio adhesion cohesion, and you can see how the specific energy is increasing with the SPT value. For normal clays, hard clays, I would say you have an SPT around 50, 60, and that's already quite a strong clay. 400 kPa clay is really very hard clay. It's dry on the outside. It's if you would see it, it already feels more like soft stone, soft rock. So 400 kPa is really a very hard clay. Okay, that's where I want to stop for today. And then we still have two more weeks, I think. So next week I will finish clay, because I have some extra things about the curling type and the tear type. So we will do next week, next Wednesday. We will start with rock cutting, and then in the last week I will talk about erosion processes. Thank you.